So hello and happy Friday. Welcome. I'm glad you're here. If by podcast at Podbean, the way to be, or here on YouTube watching the video. This is Friday the 11th, and this is episode number 113 of The Way to Be. So I'm glad you're here. Thank you for those of you who submitted these questions that we're going to discuss today. Super hot outside, 84 degrees Fahrenheit, which is 29 degrees Celsius. There will be links down in the video description below, so if you want to follow up on anything that I'm talking about today or you want to visit my main website, which is thewaytobe.org, you can do that or write your questions right down in the comment section below during this video. So the first question for today is from Martin Aperlew. How soon after you get a nuke, which is a nucleus colony of bees, should you be doing a mite check? I got my nukes on 23 May, but we have had more bad rainy weather than good. Seems I have been getting different opinions on when to do a check, but the colony is still building up and have not been drawing out comb as fast as I thought they would. So I really don't know if I should do an alcohol wash yet or if it's necessary at this time. Maybe you can tell us newbies at your next Friday talk. I will. We'll discuss it today. So there are differences in the way that you receive your bees for those of you starting out, and most of the people watching this channel are beginning or have small-scale beekeeping in their own backyards. Mite checks. One of the reasons we bring that up when you're getting new stuff is, for example, if you get your bees as a package. When you get your honeybees as a package, and I guess it's important to clarify this, you do get a queen bee with it. So you get a queen bee who's already laying, she's going to produce eggs, and then the bees that come with her are going to provide the foraging. They're going to do all the interior hive maintenance care and stuff like that until her new bees hatch out. Those are the ones that you have the greatest opportunity because they have no infrastructure yet, they haven't laid eggs, and when the queen does begin laying, we're at least 9 days out from any of that new larvae being capped over. So that's when oxalic acid vaporization is going to be most effective because the mites are phoretic, they're exposed. And that gives you an opportunity for almost a 99% knockout for the varroa mites. Now there's a difference when you get a nucleus colony, because a nucleus colony, the frames, have all of the active ingredients of a regular colony of bees that's established. You have a queen, she's already laying. These are likely to be her offspring. So the workers inside the colony are already compatible with the queen. There's no queen introduction. She's loose in there. And a lot of the brood in that nucleus colony is already capped. Now that changes what you can do to control varroa mites. And please pay attention to this. If they exist, always do a mite count to make sure before you treat. And with packages, there's always some dead bees in there. You would see some evidence of mites on the bottom. But there's another thing that you can do, and this gets into what kind of bottom board you have on your beehives. Back behind me here is a Flow Hive 2. But these screened bottom boards with removable trays or removable sticky boards and things like that are available from Betterbee, Dedant, all the different companies. Manlake sells them. So you could have a bottom board that would allow the mites to fall through a screen and then allow you to collect them and see what's going on. And the reason that I bring it up is a lot of sellers are treating for mites before they ship now. I think that's really a nice service to do with packages, in particular nucleus colonies. You want to let them get set up in their new location. We don't want them to be stressed or to depart their new location. We don't want them to swarm out prematurely. But again, it's an already established complete colony. It just happens to be small, and normally that's 5 frames. So if you have a hive, 8 or 10 frame box that has a removable tray underneath, you can look to see. It's not a meaningful mite count, but it does show us one thing for sure, if mites are in the colony at all. Eventually, you know, almost every colony, if you're in a country, a part of the world, where varroa destructor mites are already in bee colonies, you are going to see some level of mite activity in your beehives. So what I like to do is pull these trays out, wash them, get a clean slate, And especially with the Flow Hive designs, those trays are really nice and easy. Plus, they're all closed up and you control ventilation, so it's not really an open screen to the outside of the hive. So that's what I like. And if you're looking for some kind of bottom board that offers both an enclosed bottom, which I highly recommend if you're in the cold climates, and also has a screen, but a tray that you can remove. So it's a little more elaborate, probably costs a little more money, but worth having. And then you can see what's going down in there. Evidence of small hive beetles, maybe. You get to see all the propolis bits that fall down there, bits of wax, even little bee parts, little bee feet. Thank you, Randy Oliver, for showing us at the beginning of a seminar little bee feet on a macro level and asking what that was, and we couldn't even guess because it was just a part of a bee. But they're present on the bottom boards of all of your beehives. So what you look for is, are there any mites on your sticky board, on your core flute pull-out board, or in your tray, depending on the configuration you have? Is there even a single mite in there? If there isn't yet, I think you're good to go, and I wouldn't go into counting the mites. On the other side of that, once your tray is clean and you leave it in there, it's been there for a week or more, because remember, it's not a mite count method, it's just are they there check. So then you look for the mites, and teach yourself to look for mites and spot them, and clean those trays out. Also, don't let those trays fill up with water and condensation if you've got rainstorms and things like that. Pull the trays, dump them out, put them right back in, because guess what's trying? What's going on inside the hive with water in those trays? The bees are trying to dehydrate that and they can't get to it. It's an area of the interior portion of the hive that the honeybees cannot do maintenance on. So the question here is, still building up, not trying out comb as fast as I thought they would. Also, when you're setting up something new, even though it's a nucleus colony, it doesn't hurt to give them one-to-one sugar syrup to get them started. Get them going, because that's what they will use, especially if we've got inclement weather. We have two extremes going on right now, really. Some areas are getting a lot of rain, and then we look at the desert southwest, they're getting extraordinary heat without rain. Both of those things work against the bees, because during periods of heavy rain, what's going on outside? The bees are not flying and foraging much. Plus, they don't want to get pollen when the pollen's going to be wet. So that's where some people get alarmed. I've got this brand new colony out here, and it's raining outside, but you know they're flying out and they're flying back, but I don't see any pollen on them. Well, when the pollen is wet, the bees really don't want it. It's not that much of a benefit to them. Plus, when the plants are getting a lot of rain, they tend to have thinner sugar content, lower sugar content in the nectar that the bees are going to get from the plants. So once again, their resources start to dwindle. And unless they have a high sugar content, they're not going to be building a lot of wax. So it's interesting, it all plays. And then we go to the other extreme. Now we have the desert southwest, no rain, same thing happens. The nectar is going to be low. You might be able to get pollen in, so you should see that coming in, but the bees are desperately trying to keep their colonies cool enough to survive 94 to 97 degrees Fahrenheit in the brood area. They can do that adequately even under those extreme conditions over 100 degrees Fahrenheit, as long as they have access to fresh water and they can cool the colony. So we could kick off a dearth, and that may come up later today too, but look to see if any varroa exists at all in your bottom boards, and when they do, when they start showing up bit by bit, that's when you might consider doing a varroa count. So I wouldn't do it just out of general purposes. So moving right along, question number two. This comes from Shauna. Let's see, can you discuss more about cutting back a hive or splitting a hive because they are too strong and you don't want them to swarm? When and when not to do this versus keeping a strong enough to be a good honey productive hive? So you don't always have to, of course, split a hive just because the population is getting big, but you don't want to let them get ahead of you. And the way you're going to notice that is if you open and inspect a colony, and I highly recommend, especially in spring during times of increase, that you do an inspection every 1 to 2 weeks. I know for some people that's hard to do, but you're looking for a queen cup is a non-alarm. There's no big deal going on, but we need to look at population, how much space they have to expand. If we went out into my apiary right now, every second box, so the way I'm configured is I have a deep root box, then a medium super right on top of that. Throughout the apiary, all of the medium supers are full. So Then we look at the brood frames. Is there enough brood area? Are there enough drawn comb areas for the queen to continue laying? And are they putting their resources in there around the queen? And so we want to make sure that we don't get too congested, because with all of the brood that's hatching out, the numbers increase. And when we pull those frames middle of the afternoon, if you've got wall-to-wall bees on those frames in the middle of the afternoon, then by evening time, you can bet you have way more than that. So you want to be sure to expand ahead of that. So you would take that top super and you can put another one on top of that, or some people like to rotate them and put the available space immediately adjacent to the brood. This time of year, I think that's just whatever you decide to do. Much easier, obviously, to simply put a new one on top. Another thing that will help you out a lot is if the frames that you put up in those supers, because that next super for most of us, me included, would probably be for honey harvesting. So I have all mine marked for those that are going to get flow supers now already, which is rare for my neck of the woods, northeastern United States, because we don't usually get a big surplus nectar flow until late summer, early autumn. So actually they're full now and they're doing really well. So we're going to go ahead and put flow supers on them. But for those of you who are traditionally gathering your honey, you put that next box on there, that's going to be for your consumption, because the bees already have a deep and they've got a 47-pound, roughly, box of capped honey. So the next box you put up there could be for keeping. So you have to think about, are you going to be extracting that honey with a centrifugal extractor? Then the type of frame, the type of foundation that you use is going to have to hold up to extraction. And the reason I bring that up is because some people now are still thinking about when better comb first came out, the pre-drawn comb. When it first came out, it was just held in there with toothpicks, and even the company that made it, Hexacell and Better Bee, who sells it as Better Comb here in the United States, they didn't want you to put that in an extractor because they didn't feel it would hold up to it. But now we're putting them on wired frames exclusively. We're no longer using toothpicks, putting it up there in wired frames. So it's supposed to be, according to the company, capable of handling radial extraction. So centrifugal force shouldn't be able to come apart. But the reason I bring that up is some people want to put foundationless frames up there because they think that's a more wholesome way to let the bees draw their own comb, which uses a lot of their honey resources, by the way. But they also think that the comb is just more wholesome, and then they'll get these full frames of honey. But here's where that kind of hits a snag, and that's when you go to extract. So if you're going to put that in any kind of centrifuge, then the dynamics might actually flex out that comb. You could lose it and destroy it and then have a mess also in your extractor. So, but if you're doing crush and strain, or if you're making cut comb from that, then you do want them to draw out their own wax from the top bar of those frames. So those are just some things to consider. But if you put better comb up there, wire reinforced, first couple of frames in the middle, directly over the next box that's below there, put those frames directly in the middle that have the drawn out comb, and that gives your bees an immediate area to start storing stuff. Because sometimes when they're planning to swarm, if you just put up foundation, so this is what better comb would look like. And this is the one that's got the little queen marking thing on it, just for kicks and giggles. And then here's one that just has heavy waxed plastic foundation. And heavy waxed is key if you're going to put in plastic foundation. But this one, if they're making any preparations to get out of there, if they're even being congested to the point where they might start to build swarm cells, which would show up along the bottom edges of the frames, then this will not alleviate that stress. They don't often draw that out. But if you put pre-drawn comb, like better comb, or if you just happen to have previously extracted frames of full depth cells, you put those up there in the center and then let the ones that you want them to draw it on their own go outboard, starting at the one position or ending at the 10th position if it's a 10 frame box. You also have the option for an 8 frame box. So just because the populations are big, just because there's a nectar flow, doesn't mean they're making preparations to swarm. And we need to do inspections to see what they're doing, see if they're starting to construct queen cells. So I hope that helps with that. The other thing is, during a dearth, if you don't do anything, if you don't feed, if you don't take care of them during a dearth, sometimes some queens, depending on the stock that you're using, will stop laying or greatly reduce their lay. And this is where we get into the, do you feed them? Do you not feed them? If you're following Dr. Leo Sherishkin's Beekeeping with a Smile, you won't be feeding them. You'll let them naturally decline in numbers and naturally build up in numbers at the end of the year. And they may not build up fast enough in time to take full advantage of that fall nectar flow. Whereas if you provide them with the resources and the areas that they need to store their nectar and ultimately turn it into honey, then putting feed on at that time can keep them up to speed and keep them from going into kind of a economic recession. But you have to be careful about what amount you feed and what you're feeding, because it could very well end up in your honey that you're extracting. So that's the other end of it. Now, where I live, I don't have to worry about feeding this time of year because the environment, thankfully, is providing everything that they need. But I know in other areas, it could be a simple situation where if you don't do it, the bee numbers can get so low that they absolutely can't survive winter. So if we're talking about a survival level colony, then I recommend feeding. If it's a healthy colony and they're robust, they've already got that full super on, then I recommend not feeding. Question number three. Casey Jones made me think of the railroad song from when I was a kid. Casey Jones just got stung by a honeybee for the first time in 10 years. Just went through a full body reaction. Felt like my entire body was getting hit by fire ants. Next time, will this be better? Or do I need to sell my hive and quit while I'm alive? Used to have over 30 hives 10 years ago and lost them all to wax moths. Decided to get back into it, but I have never went through this before. Okay, first of all, I have to say and qualify answers that I give, because a lot of people are asking me health-related questions and I'm not qualified to do it. My health emergency medical background is that I used to be an EMT. I used to be a rescue diver, and I used to be a rescue swimmer, and I used to be a lifeguard, and also I used to teach CPR. That's the extent of it, so I'm no medical expert. I'm an emergency guy. Used to be. Past tense. Now I'm just a coffee drinker. So I can't answer questions about health, but I will tell you this, and I'm going to describe it because this is important for new beekeepers, because often you don't know what might happen when you get stung by a bee and what constitutes a medical emergency and what doesn't. So again, not a physician, just a person who's been around bees and disasters. So here's another thing. Notice on my hand, I have my ring. So if you have wedding rings, for example, I did not wear rings on my hands for many years. And that's because if you get any kind of injury, that ring, that piece of jewelry could be part of what turns into an emergency situation. If you have a ring on your hands and you're sticking your hands in your beehive and you get stung by a bee on the hand, and then your hand swells up, which some people that have not been stung a lot, their hands often do swell up. If you've got a ring on there, you got to get that ring off, and it's not going to pull off down your finger the way it normally should. Now you're in a situation where you have to cut the ring off to keep the blood flowing to your appendages, right? So that's first. I highly recommend not wearing any jewelry that restricts or potentially restricts blood flow when you're working in your bee yard. So the other thing is, what's normal? You get stung on the hand, your hand could swell up, it gets hot, feverish, maybe a little itchy. How long should that last? It can last for several days. Also, you can be stung on the hand and you can get swelling all the way up to your elbow, for example. Again, those are not alarming things to happen, right? But if you get stung on the hand, and as described here, the reaction is all over the body. The worst case scenario is anaphylaxis. So if you go into anaphylactic shock, your body's really reacting and you can actually have your airway restricted. So that is at the top of the list for a medical emergency. A restricted airway. So you need to be consulting with a physician about your level of sensitivity, your level of being allergic to bees, the proteins in bee venom, And if you have a situation where you're one of those people who is allergic enough, I'm not a huge fan of people carrying around an EpiPen and continuing to work with venomous insects that may cause that reaction. So my advice to anyone who has a potentially life-threatening reaction or a non-localized reaction to a bee sting is that you seriously reconsider whether you should be keeping and managing honeybees. I know people do it. I know people don't want to be told that they can't do it. I'm just telling you that why risk your life? Because you really have to have a second person around when you're working in the bees in case you become a medical emergency. For those who are not allergic, then you can be out there working by yourself. If I had to be out there and my wife had to be out there with her cell phone, ready to dial 911 the way she does when I go after defensive bees on behalf of other people, then I wouldn't keep bees. So personally, I wouldn't do it. So that's just it. If you have a normal reaction, localized swelling, pain, you know, and it goes away after a few days, then you're probably okay. But always, always consult with a physician if you're having any kind of reaction beyond that. Question number four, Walter Morgan, Titusville, Pennsylvania. Just put a new swarm into a Hoover Hive deep brood box. Now, those of you who don't know what the Hoover Hives are, I did a review of the Hoover Hives. They're initially dipped in paraffin wax, which soaks into all the open cells of the wood, and it handles high temperature. And then the final dipping is 100% beeswax, according to the people that make it. So that's just to set this up for you. The entire hive, inside and outside, is covered in beeswax. So I plan to do a varroa test this week, and if there are varroa present, do an oxalic acid vaporization before any capped brood are present. So just as we described before, that would happen before the 9th or 10th day, that so you could get those varroa before they get underneath that capped brood. I have a pan-style vaporizer. Do you see any problem using this on the heavily waxed Hoover bottom board? And I hadn't really thought about it because I use the ProVap 110, which doesn't rest the hot pan on the bottom surface of your hive. So two things are risky about using the pan-style vaporizers. When you stick them through the entrance to do the vaporization treatment, you need to hold the handle up so that the pan stays down, because if you let the handle go down and the pan goes up, it could be in contact with the bottom of the frames inside the hive. What's on the bottom? Potentially beeswax. Beeswax is highly flammable, if you didn't already know. So you can actually set fire to your beehive. So I always recommend that people hold the handle and keep the pan down, and usually it's a bottom board that is unfinished, so it doesn't reach combustion temperature. What temperature does paper burn at in Fahrenheit? Fahrenheit 451. Thank you, Ray Bradbury. So anyway, what would you do? You would take something like a piece of metal. This is just for example. But if you get a piece of aluminum flashing next time you're at the hardware store, just a flat piece of aluminum, and stick that in your hive on the bottom board first. Stick your pan in there and rest it on that metal. The aluminum flashing serves to dissipate the heat, and you would not have a concentrated point for combustion inside the hive. Three parts of the fire triangle: fuel, which is going to be the wax that's on the wood, temperature, which you're going to raise with your pan, and oxygen, which is already there. So it's a potential fire inside the hive. The other thing that you can do, and I recommended to Walter here, was that you do a destructive test. We know that outside the hive, the landing board is already covered in wax. So you could actually do your test outside without any oxalic acid in the pan at all, of course, because we don't just want oxalic acid to go into the air everywhere as it sublimates. So then you set the pan on there, run it through its normal heat cycle, and see what the beeswax does. See if you get the potential. But we can remove all doubt by putting in a piece of aluminum. That would then, of course, distribute the heat better. And these pans are also generally made out of cast aluminum. So I hope that answers that question. Do a test ahead of time, dissipate heat, do not come in contact with the bottoms of the frames, keep your pan flat on the bottom board. Or go to a ProVape 110 if you want to blow the big bucks and drill a quarter inch hole in the back of your hive. Then you're just putting a tube in there and delivering it that way. Next question, number 5, comes from Jackie R. Someone recently was discussing the difference between smoking and spraying with honeybee healthy sugar water mix, and said that if you got stung, it would not mask the alarm pheromone. What are your thoughts on this? If you, for example, drop a frame accidentally or get an angry bee, the sugar syrup mix won't help. How true or false do you feel that statement is? I didn't know, so I wasn't about to jump in on the argument against using it, but maybe you have an experience to go by regarding that. Okay, so here's the thing. Super hot days. We have nice hot days right now. There is no question that if you've got a colony of bees that even is the least bit feisty, you open them up and they're just ready to come at you. First of all, you might want to reconsider whether or not you would even be looking into that hive of bees to begin with. The second thing is, what time of day are you looking in there? So we want to go afternoon. I like 1 to 2 p.m. on average. We're backyard beekeepers. We don't have 100 hives to get through, so we can pick and choose when we want to do it. What conditions do we want outside? We want sunny conditions, clear conditions. We don't want a heavy overcast day when it just finished raining and there's just now a break in the rain and we want to run out there and get in there. So we want to make sure that as many foragers are out of that colony as possible, and you do that by inspecting a little after midday. Another advantage to that is going to be that the sun is going to be nice and high in the air, and it's going to shine right down inside the hive, which gives us better visibility when we look at the hive. So these are all the things that qualify what you're going to use when you go into the hive. Now, I like to take 1-to-1 sugar syrup, mix that up, and then I add 1-to-2 teaspoons of Honeybee Healthy or Pro Health or Beekeeper's Choice, whatever essential oil premix that you decide to use. They're heavy on lemongrass and stuff like that. So anyway, once you mix that all together, here's what I do. Number one, when you get into a beehive and you start taking it apart, inevitably you disrupt the tissue which is made by the bees, which is out of beeswax, between the frames, one box to another, what's always in there? As soon as you pop the inner cover, there's a whole bunch of honey that gets in there. So right now we're kind of in a dearth. So now what happens is when it's hot, if you're in a dearth area, then the bees that are scouting around are going to smell that honey. They're going to zip in there and they're going to start feeding on that. And that can cause a conflict already. You can disrupt that, no question, with smoke. So it also doesn't necessarily stop them from getting robbed, because it's the alarm pheromone we're interrupting, not the smell of honey in the air. So one of the advantages, so we're talking, I'm just giving you discussion points. There really is no reason to argue to the ground over smoke versus using Honeybee Healthy with sugar syrup. It's just not worth it. If that's what they don't want to use, then they don't need to use it. So you have to be a judge of the temperament of the colony that you're working with. So another thing I like to do is, if I'm going to go out in the apiary right now, there are 14 colonies out there. I would go around with the Honeybee Healthy and sugar syrup, and I would spray every landing board in the apiary, because now they're all smelling the same thing. They're getting a little sugar syrup there, and they're all somewhat content while we go. And then I spritz the landing board of the colony that I'm going to inspect. And when I open it up, I spritz a little bit of that in there. And then you can see immediately what the bees are doing. How are they responding? So we sprayed a little sugar syrup in there with Honeybee Healthy in it. It is not as interrupting as the smoke would be. Also, though, it doesn't drive all the bees down below to seek shelter as they would when they perceive that there's some kind of forest fire nearby, which is what the smoke is going to do. It's going to drive them to consume honey and to seek deep shelter. So if we're spritzing with sugar syrup, we've just occupied them. If there's guard bees out there and they're like looking at you, every move you make, they're like looking at you, give them a couple direct hits with sugar syrup, see if they don't go away. If they take to the air and start buzzing your face and stuff, then you start to rethink things. But all the sugar syrup and Honeybee Healthy does is occupy them, gives them a distraction, and adds a scent to the area that tells them that you're there. So if you're using Honeybee Healthy whenever they smell it, their little tongues come out and they're ready to be fed. Like when you're holding a treat in front of a dog. When they see the treat, they know something's going to happen. They start salivating. They start preparing to eat the treat. So the bees are the same thing. When they smell something they've smelled before that has resulted in a sugar reward, their proboscis swings up and their tongue starts to come out already. Before you even spritz them, just because they smelled it on an adjacent frame, and then you hit them with it, now they get to drink some. That's all it is. And because it's hot outside, I don't like to hit them with smoke because I don't, if I don't need to. So now I don't recommend going into your colony with nothing. No spritzing, no smoke, nothing. I know there's people, their bees love them, they just would never sting them. But I'm here to tell you, if you don't have your smoker ready somewhere, so that's the other end of it. With a honeybee healthy spritzer, I always have at least two smokers hanging off my golf cart, ready to ignite should things get a little bit hostile, so I can finish doing what I'm doing and then put everything away. Have I had to do that? No, it's a contingency plan. So I have smokers full of pine shavings ready to light, and I have the igniter right next to them. They're preloaded, they're ready to go, but I use the sugar syrup first, and if that's not working, I'll just shift to smoke. But if I look at the landing board at the beginning of my inspection, so a lot happens before you ever get into the bees. Kneel down to the side of the hive, take a look at the landing board and see what's going on. Look what the guard bees are doing. Are they on high alert? Are ready for some reason that you may not even be aware of? They might not be. If there's not a lot of guard bee activity, are the guard bees staring at you and moving closer to you and coming close and their little mandibles are open and the little forelimbs are up in the air? Are they doing that? That's a defensive colony. You might start to rethink what you're about to do with that colony. But if they're totally passive and they don't care and they're not paying any attention to you at all, good candidate for sugar syrup with honeybee healthy in it. Now, there's some studies done. Now, we have to be careful when we look into studies, because we have to look at who did the study, what the purpose of the study was, and who's profiting potentially from the study. So there's piles of anecdotal information about the use of honeybee healthy. Everything from boosting colonies, boosting their numbers. Some people even claim that it kills varroa mites. There is zero supporting science for that right now. So the other thing is, most of the people that are claiming that they do these great things, like can even calm a colony that is being led by a, not being led by, but highly impacted by laying workers, which would reject new queens coming in. They say that if you spray down the colony with honeybee healthy and sugar syrup, put a good dose all over everybody and spray it all around that queen cage, that will help them accept the new queen. And there is quite a bit of evidence that that's the case, but there's no solid scientific study having been done with controls and everything else to show that that would not be the case, or for example, that that wouldn't have worked if all you did was spray with the one-to-one sugar syrup. So these are all, you know, attempts, of course, sell honeybee healthy to everybody. That's the goal if you make it. And I believe the company that makes honeybee healthy, I think that's all they do. They do have, you know, there are professors, they are, you know, people of science that developed it to begin with. The question is at the other end, what really is the benefit of it? But I hope that helped. Those are my parameters for why I use it, when I use it, and what's going on. Nothing's worth arguing over, however. So that's it. Next question, number 6. Be kind to be free is the YouTube channel for this person. Our mite loads are low. 1 mite in all 8 hives with washes. So washes are alcohol washes generally. We purchased 3 of these over 2 years, and the local Northern Survivor seller treats with oxalic before winter. We were going to do the same, but the temps dropped before we did, and I was too chicken to open the hive back up to mess with them. Last year, we used Formic Pro in 1 hive, and that popped a 9 mite roll in July. So the hive, they did an inspection, they saw 9 mites that justified the treatment with Formic Pro. And it made a huge mess. Bees propolized it. So the way Formic Pro works is, it's these little packets. There are Formic quick strips But there's Formic Pro, are little packets that look like silica gel packs. They look kind of like this. And when you peel them out of their aluminum holders, they off-gas, heavy, very stinky. So the bees propolized it because they must have left it in long enough, possibly because it is so noxious, but it worked. The hive has been mite-free ever since, and I think the rest of our mite luck was due to the timely natural brood breaks and splits. So that's true. Those that are having bees swarm that have lost queens, and they see the queen cells and they're replacing them and everything else. The good news of that is that that's a natural brood break and will result in fewer opportunities for mites to reproduce, and subsequently fewer mites are in the colony. And then you partner that with bee stock that might be hygienic or mite resistant. They might groom away mites and they might pull out pupa and developing larvae that are infected with mites. Then we've got a really good colony. Where would these mites be showing up? Also on the bottom board, through your screen board, on your trays, on your sticky boards, and on your core flute, depending on what you have. So once again, being aware of what the mite loads are is really important. So sometime when you're moving a hive, okay, there's another question about how I've moved my hives, but let's talk about the Formic Pro. I have a bunch of it. Have not used any of it this year because, like so many people this year, which is really funny good, is we're having very low mite counts. So for example, yesterday I was out there because I lay out 200 feet of garden hose. And why do I do that? Because the sun is really hot, and then the garden hose heats up all the water that's in it, and then I pull these trays out, and now I'm out there hitting those trays with hot water. That washes everything away really fast. Highly recommended. So that's actually a solar water heater of sorts. Anyway, so I was hosing out all the trays. I was pulling out all of the flow hives and looking for mites. I had one mite in one tray, and that was over a period of weeks. So I don't know what's going on this year. I did not do a spring mite treatment. The last mite treatment that we did was at the end of November, beginning of December. That's it. We have had swarms and we've had things like that, and I've done lots of splits this year because we had losses of bees through the wintertime. And remember, I want to build just from my own bees to get the apiary back online. The only new bees that we brought in were the Saskatrass bees to repopulate the horizontal hive, the long Langstroth hive, and they're doing fantastic. They also demonstrated that they did not have mites on them this year. We might be in great shape. So I don't know what's going on, but it's all good. So that's it. When you're using Formic Pro, the thing is, if you use it, of course, it's so volatile that it drives the mites out, but it also can be treated with your honey supers on. It also will take care of the mites through the capped brood. But some people have problems with it because it drives the bees out of the colonies. So you have a couple of choices with it, and one is to do a single treatment of two strips over the brood box at the same time, and you get this overwhelmingly powerful smell for the first 2 to 3 days. After that, it dramatically drops off. No big surprise that corresponding with that strongest smell that you smell, you have the biggest and most rapid mite drop also in the first 2 to 3 days. So you get options. Use two strips at once in a single treatment, or you can take them and put one strip on over the brood box, leave that for 10 days, put another strip on at the 10-day mark, and leave that for the next 10 days. And some people end up just leaving them there. I don't recommend that. I would remove it. And I think because based on this description here, maybe those strips were left there, and that's why the bees were propolizing it and trying to chew it, trying to get rid of a foreign body from the hive. So the other thing is, second question, sometimes when you're moving a hive, can you show how you're prepared for transport? Are you talking about smaller hives for ease of handling, or are you using your new hive totes? Well, first of all, I've never moved a full-size hive with full honey supers on. The only hives I move are those that are single deeps. So single deep brood box, 10 or 8, and those can be plenty heavy. But I go around the sides and I screw brackets onto them. And some of them even have the new clamps, the screw clamps on there that I've used on my horizontal hive to keep that closed because they're super convenient. And that was my big idea for having a swarm box to take with me wherever I go. So now that the hive butlers are out here and I wised up last year and bought some, those are how I transport everything. So if I'm gonna move a hive, for example, that means I take the hive butler totes, and they have optional tops, a solid top or a screened top. So we're gonna move a colony of bees. I use the screened top. All I do is set the hive butler tote right next to it. I pull each frame and keep it in the same order because each hive butler holds 10 frames, just like a 10 frame deep would hold. And there's plenty of space next to them and under them. So if you pull a frame, you've got some queen cells on there that you don't want to damage, there's space at the bottom in the hive butlers that accommodates that, so you don't go smashing them. So that's a good thing too. It's also great for when you're doing splits. So I mark these up for different special purposes. So I have them for swarm collection, because that's what I like to use now too, because they're nice and big, slick interior sides. They're totally washable, so you hose them out later with your sun-heated garden hose, by the way, if you have that. So anyway, when I'm moving a hive, I pull all the frames out, put them in a hive butler, put the screen top on it, use zip ties to hold those corners down. Now I don't have to worry about the hive shifting in the back of my vehicle and the parts coming apart, or, you know, the entrance screen that you block on there coming apart. Plus, before we transfer it somewhere, it gives me a chance to do some hive equipment maintenance. Scrape the bottom board, scrape off the extra propolis, make sure it's all clean fitting and everything. And if I have to do something to repair it, replace a component, new bottom board, something like that, that's the same time that I do all of that while my bees are all settled inside that hive butler. The other thing is, what time of day am I doing that? I like to do it before sunrise. So rather than just at nightfall, I like to wait until the following morning, 4 or 5 o'clock in the morning, pull the frames out, start to do all that work then. Here's the other thing you should know. If you're going to move your bees and shift stuff around at nighttime, if you're going to open the hive, which I highly recommend you don't at night, but if you open your hive at night, you know what the bees do? They can't fly, they can't see. They already, you know, their vision's not awesome. It's a very low pixel rate camera if you were looking at their eyes and what they sense. So when they can't see, what do? They're grounded. What do they do when they're grounded? They crawl along the ground. What do they find? You. What do they climb? They climb on you. They climb up your pant legs. They climb up under the cuffs of your pant legs and everything else. So you need to be prepared for a bunch of bees in the dark. If they're released and you're going to manipulate hives at that time, that they'll be climbing all over you. So it's not the best time. You need to button things up at nightfall and then do your transferring around the following morning. So if that makes sense, hope that works. And then of course, open everything out once you're in the new location and rehive everything and set everything up all nice and tidy. So that's pretty much it for that question, number 6. Now we're on to number 7. And this is from Rob Strickland. He says, a new fungus strain effective against varroa mites and honeybee colonies. I'm sure you've been reading articles like this regarding possible advances in varroa control. I'm just hoping that it really does become an effective treatment against varroa. I'm relatively new to beekeeping, so we would appreciate hearing your thoughts and what other information on this you may have read recently. Could you maybe even talk about this on your next Way to Be YouTube video? Yes, I could. So most of you are familiar with Paul Stamets. He's the guy that talks about fungi perfecti and all these supplements that are fungus related. So that he talks a lot about the microbiome. He's done TED Talks. And he's tried for years to come up with fungi that will attack and kill varroa destructor mites inside the beehive. What's the problem? Why didn't that work? It doesn't work because of the temperatures that the bees keep their hives, especially in the brood area, 94 to 97 degrees Fahrenheit. The fungi that he was putting in there would not live. They wouldn't survive and therefore couldn't do their job and couldn't kill the varroa destructor mites. But as was discussed here, I'm going to give you guys some further reading if you want to check it out yourself. This comes from Washington State University Insider, dated May the 27th of 2021. So this is hot off of the research press. So people getting their doctorates are working on this stuff. So anyway, Paul is also being consulted by them. I mean, anybody that goes into this area would be silly not to check in with Paul. So I just did some stuff. I want you to know where it's headed because this is not coming out immediately. They have a plan. The plan is, of course, this would be like little mite-destroying beneficial fungi that would go after them and take them out and then not hurt anything else. And so in the lab, under controlled situations, under controlled environments, they're culturing strains that can handle higher temperatures. No big surprise. That doesn't happen overnight. It takes a lot of research, takes a lot of resources, takes a lot of time and energy. So I'm just going to read an excerpt from Washington State to let you know. Is it Washington State? Yeah, Washington State University Insider. The next step is to seek approval from the Environmental Protection Agency to use, I'm going to mispronounce this, but it's metarhizium on hives used in agriculture. The team must also finalize delivery methods for beekeepers to apply the fungus in hives. We hope in 10 years that rather than chemical miticides, metarhizium, is widely used to control varroa mites, Shepherd said, and that the mite problem for beekeepers has been significantly reduced. The team thinks the methods they developed to evolve for varroa control could be used to improve biocontrol agents in other crop systems as well. The majority of the funding for this work came from private donations from individuals and foundations. Additional funding came from Washington State Department of Agriculture, WSDA Specialty Crop Block Grant, K2531, and the USDA National Institute of Food and Agriculture. So there's a lot going on. It's going to be, you know, waiting game while they're doing all their research and everything. And of course, everybody has to be on board with it. Here's the conflict, right? Because people that make the chemicals that currently are being sold to treat for the varroa destructive mite will want to make sure that they're not just put right out of business, especially some of these really big companies. Obviously, the people that make oxalic acid aren't going to flip out about it because oxalic acid has many, many uses, but it's the other treatments that are going to fall by the wayside if we come up with a natural treatment. And I really like what they said at the end, that they would like to use that on a lot of pests in agriculture, and therefore we can maybe get some of these chemicals out of there that are being used as pesticide control. So that was the last question for today. I know, that went really fast. So we're on the fluff here. But I did an inspection, was in the hives the day before yesterday, and I was looking at some of my experiments to see how they work, and these are just grassroots level. This isn't big science. What happened was I was doing inspections of other colonies that had a bunch of queen cells on the edges of their frames, had a new camera with me that's really high resolution, so it's a super kicker, and started to photograph the different faces of the frames and everything because I wanted to use it for other stuff, want to get some high res, large photos and things like that. Wouldn't you know it, the queens start showing up. And one of the things that I had done was pulled queen cells out of hives, just cut them out really careful, the whole queen cell there, cut it off, and very carefully took that out. And I even sat it on top of another beehive because I really didn't care about it. And then later on that day when I was doing an inspection of another colony, they were queenless. So what did I decide to do? Not only were they queenless, they didn't have the potential to make a replacement queen, which means they didn't have any eggs in the colony. They didn't have any freshly hatched eggs, so really young larvae. That's what you need. If you don't have it, they have no means of rebuilding the colony. So I took those two very interesting queen cells, took my hive tool and just cut into some of the wax in the middle of one of their brood frames, and then I just stuck my little capped queen cells in there. 11 to 12 days later, here I am inspecting that hive again to see what's going on, and one of those queens obviously made it, and she was just beginning to lay her first eggs because she only had like 20 cells with eggs in them. So that was a success story, but there I was with this big fat queen that was obviously laying, and I didn't have my white marking paint pen with me. Super frustrated. So I'm saying, have these pens handy. You never know when you're going to come across your queen. You might want to mark her. The other thing is, always have some kind of queen cage. I want you to see this one. And notice that I've put a rubber band around it, because a lot of people have these clip styles. But what happens is the little spring mechanism in there, or they get sticky with propolis and stuff and wax. And what happens is you think you put the queen in here, release her, and you let that go, and it doesn't close all the way. Next thing you know, your queen scoots right out and runs down your shirt sleeve or whatever. So rubber band, leave the rubber band on there. And of course, you can clamp that right up. There's a bunch of different styles of queen cages. But the other thing that I just could have done it. It was right there. All I had to do was pick her up by her wings and mark her thorax there. And then I could have let her dry out inside a queen cage. Always let the queen dry out before you return her to the colony. And the reason that after we mark her, we put her in one of these, is because I can complete the rest of the inspection, the manipulation of the frames and everything else without any concerns about where the queen is and if I might be potentially harming her while I do my inspection. So temporary holding, have extra paint pens in your pocket of your bee jacket or whatever you wear when you inspect your stuff. Next one, don't forget Hives for Heroes. If you're looking for something to lend your time and energy to, if you want to be a mentor to a veteran, if you want to support them by donating a hive or something like that, Hives for Heroes National Program, just Google it. Also, because there's so many of these, if you haven't done it already, just click the like button down there and you'll know that you've watched this video today. And the photo that I took of the queen with this camera that I was using ended up making a 26 by 34 some odd inch 300 dpi image of the whole surface of that brood frame with the queen in the middle. Her retinue of worker bees are around her. There's drones on there. There's worker bees all over. There's of course the brood comb. There's stored pollen. There's nectar that's uncapped, and then there's capped honey. So all of this is in one crystal clear giganto image. And I just put that up. So if somebody's looking for a poster to hang up that's educational for your kids, or if you're teaching about bees, or you like to bring a poster when you're educating people about bees, the only thing that's not represented in that would be new eggs, because that queen was just starting to lay, and there's no open larvae there, and of course, no capped brood. So it's just bees, but it's pretty cool. So thank you for watching today. I hope that you got something out of it. And I want to thank you for spending your time here. And I hope you have a fantastic weekend. Thanks for watching.